The Narrator. First chapter. An army is a horror. It's a horrible thing. They say you might change your mind about that when the country is invaded and your people are suffering wrong. But for me, this is all just more horror. More army horror. It's through rags of fast-moving smoke that I first catch sight of Treff. I'm standing in the pass, to one side of the pumice road, looking down from my perch on the massed roots of some dusty old cork oaks. The city below me is like a shining, smoking lake, thrusting its troubled glints into my eyes and making them smart. Overhead, the sun is lost in a white sky without circumference, above the flashing waters of the city. One flash of the sun, and I am down in its streets. Why is the station so far out of the city limits anyway? Most likely a collusion between the builders of stations and the builders of long roads. I walk into Treff, unremarked as a ghost. And now this is me, here, in its bare, broad avenues. The sky showers the street in volleys of sharp light. I take step after step, feeling the street and the city existing all around me, like figuring out all the parts of an unfamiliar flavor. My mind is too tired and weak from travel to do much of it. The city washes by me, and its outlines dance and glitter as they will, playing their fairy games with me. I stumble along in a boulevard so wide, the opposite side seems to sit on the horizon, and the whole world bulging in between me and there. Out from my pocket, I pull again to look at the implacable pink lot that tells me that I am drafted. Drafted. I put in for an exemption and I got drafted. I look up just as the sun quits the sky. I am sprawling in a white wrought iron chair in the paved court of cafes. The iron finery is biting into my back a little. The table is streaked with sunset bands on the glass top, heavy and tippy at once. Bands of gold and rust light cut across my coffee ring. The ticket is still there in my right hand, on my right thigh. A little wind toys with it there. The battered paper is soft and tough as a piece of linen. Why can't I awake from this dream? This is an ugly dream. These words seem to come from an old song. I came from the village named for the sheepfold. It was the first thing probably built there, where the highway broadens on the mountain. In the heavens, constellations of the spring. When I was in my third year at the College of Narrators, Twiss, who was our ward resident, passed word of the draft around and told us to get in our exemption forms early. Next thing I know, I pull a pink lot from an envelope in the mailroom and stand staring at it, welded to the spot. "How did that happen?" Twiss asked, peering over my shoulder. He took the paper gingerly in his hands. "No," his head shaking. "You should go see the Uz about this." Twiss walked away with his sharp, upturned nose in the air. My friend Spina was with me and rested a hand on my shoulder. "Run away," he said. I looked at him. "Stay with Blue Loom Pigsty or your other uncle, whatever his name was. Lard Loom Blossom." If you can keep out of sight for a few months, you'll probably be forgotten. I'd be killed. You might, he says sadly. But you take the same chance in the war. What about my degree? You can forget your degree. Everyone here would certainly sympathize with you. I should at least try to clear this up with you, as I say. My mind is like a motionless reflection in a piece of glass. My thoughts are frozen in place, too frightened to move. Oh, he won't do anything, Spina said with a look of disgust. You might as well tell your troubles to these chairs. I have my copies of the documents. I have my dated registration. I kept everything, just in case. I suppose he might listen, but that's only because anything is possible with these administrators. He's white. Spina shrugged his meaty shoulders. I honestly don't believe they really think at all. Where would I go if I had to run? Back into the mountains, Spina says unhelpfully. Winter comes so swiftly in the mountains that the leaves are frozen green on the trees, the grass in the meadows. The foliage never turns color or falls, but hibernates in clear ice casings until the spring thaw restores their interrupted life again. So the winter landscape is tinkling green, dazzling with flakes of light, crisp through the snow. The many rock-lipped streams freeze clear as well, and the fish are suspended in place like spangles of precious metal until spring. I walked to the small cluster of administrative buildings, a clutch of cottages and shops connected by a tangle of gravel paths, and baffled from sight like an embarrassment by several echelons of yew hedges. I passed through these under boughs of cherry trees, the scarlet cherries still on the branches, glowing like embers through the ice that outlined every leaf and twig in shining white thread, and I saw myself endlessly multiplied in all that pure ice, even on the yew branches, their deep green, almost black, and webs of gossamer ice in the recesses of the hedges. A dark, bulbous, top-heavy figure loomed in and out of them as I passed, arms anxiously swinging. I never have been able to find out how the administrators get their posts, or why they all seem so unqualified and unhelpful. I walked in among the dozen or so buildings, with smoke in my face, blown down toward the ground from the chimneys of the cottages to my left. One of the administrators, a white old woman in a shawl, was spinning in a doorway, muttering around a short clay pipe to a sharply dressed aide who avidly took down her dictation. The woman eyed me as I passed, without slowing her spinning or her smoky speaking. I glanced at her, then at once dropped my eyes to the thick ankles, slotted into shoes so tight they seemed painted on. While her look was cryptic, her aide, who was red, shot me a glance of unmistakable disapproval. I was tempted to fling a handful of snow at them, but after all I might need to persuade them of my goodwill later. So I belatedly turned, as I had already passed nearly altogether out of sight of them, and made a sort of half-wave, half-salute, along with what I felt was a strained and unappealing smile. Some smiles break a face, and some smiles tear across. Stark white and clean as a surgery, Uzlime's office was like an ice cave all year. A small white box of a building with two nearly wall-sized windows in the front, square door in the middle that swings back silently on big hinges. His secretary, absent when I came, would sit behind a high marble-topped counter. Bright sunlight from the windows was reflected and re-reflected all throughout the open office, and I could see Lime back there in the rearmost recesses. His desk was steel with a marble top, and there were chrome and marble counters and frigid glass-fronted cabinets on the walls. Some had files in them, and some had bright steel implements, most of which looked medical, but some were clerical, staplers, and hole punchers. When he saw me, Lime crossed to the sink and, humming, began soaping his hands wildly, flipping gobs of foam in all directions. He then undulated forward up to his desk, his gait deformed by a wooden right leg. He was a large, round-headed man with white hair, parted on the left. Like most administrators, and this was always attributed to chance, he was a white person from the valleys on the other side of the mountains. His shirt and satin cravat, his long waistcoat and longer jacket were white, his trousers were black and white checked, his leg was white wood. He dropped with one loud crack into his seat and waved me forward with a rather inane grin. I sat stupidly before his desk and concisely explained my problem, laying out my paperwork with ostentatious care in the desolation in front of him. "I have just received this draft notice." I placed my finger straight up and down on it, on the desk. "Even though I submitted a valid application for exemption as a student of the College of Narrators well in advance of the application deadline." It was Lime's expression hadn't changed.
"So?"
he grinned at me.
"So there's been a mistake."
"And?"
"And I'd like you to fix it."
"Don't be an ass," he said unctuously.
"Who's an ass?" I cried. "I applied for an exemption and I got a draft notice. Now is this application in order and on time or isn't it?"
He looked at me, and the light was very bright all around. He didn't answer. I might not even be there anymore from his point of view.
"This is idiotic," I said helplessly. "I have to matriculate."
His fingertips rebounded cheerily off each other like rubber bladders. I could hear his cheeks creaking as his smile winched itself up his face. His smile would handle me. Now that it had put in its appearance, he could abscond from behind it. The smile shook at me, as though this were an excellently thorough explanation. And then it was the train, smiling at me through clouds of steam and grunts of smoke. No family there, not much family to speak of, and Spina had already said goodbye to me the night before. I hear a voice call my name, turn to see a reed-thin old man in a sort of cassock advancing on me with an envelope in his hand. The letter.
"My dear Lou, how foolish of you. You know it was foolish. Not to register with the document's registrar. They have, at this moment, 3 excellent positions open for persons fluid in Lashlake, and you, with the sole exception of Professor Tmendo himself, would have been the only candidate locally available. There naturally is nothing now to be done, poor thing, about it, because your draft notice establishes prior government service in the military, which obviously invalidates a document's registry exemption. Don't imagine, however, that the question of your military service is in any way settled, however. I have composed a letter to the regional advocate, etc., explaining your case in detail, and we believe a response is pending. I have also informed a friend of mine in the military administration of your predicament, and he has seen to it you will be given an interpreter's assignment, which official recognition of yourself as an interpreter will represent a distinct advantage in putting forward your case for transfer to the documentary board, which case I am taking personally. In hand, Uz Lime." My name is Low, not Lul. He wrote fluid for fluent, D-R-A-U-G-H-T for D-R-A-F-T, and repeated, however, inappropriately at the end of the first sentence of the second paragraph. Furthermore, I had registered with a document's registry through Professor Tmendo, who was my Lash Lake instructor 2 years ago.
Had he forgotten to file it?
The messenger stood waiting with his hand out. I dropped a coin in it, and he angrily dashed it to the ground and reopened his palm. I looked at him interrogatively. "What did you do that for?"
"I need your original draft notice," he snapped,
and pointed violently to the new pink lot that remained in the envelope. I pulled from my pocket my original yellow lot and gave it to him, whereupon he whipped around on his heel and stormed off the platform. I picked up my coin and then looked at the new lot. I looked a long time without understanding. My original lot had me joining the local battalion, the so-called 15-milers, whose rallying point was in Cool Elbow, about 3 miles down into the river valley on this side of the mountains. The lot I was then holding assigned me to an entirely other army. Red Expedition Chapter, rallying 300 miles away in Treff. I was dealing with agents of an offended spirit or capricious god. I eat and step out onto the streets, nearly colliding with a pale man. He is lean and tall, with a small head and blazing round blue pinpoint eyes, staring up at the sun in amazed ecstasy and oblivious to me. His thin red hair hangs lifelessly down in ragged locks. His arms hang down at his sides, and his smocked outline seems to wobble in the intense, chilled light. Behind the man, an edek emerges from her underground den. The edek is taller than this tall man, who is her helper, and like all edeks, she wears a close hood of dun cloth with two holes for her eyes, fitted into a bandage of thin gauze tape, wound many times around the long neck. This one is dressed in a uniform of velvety brown corduroy, with the straps of her binoculars across her narrow chest and knee-high boots of soft-laced pigskin. The rooty, gloved hands glow a little. One reaches to pinch a bit of material at the back of her helper's smock, and her helper, whose eyes are the edek's to use, leads her past me. The edek's head swivels in my direction as she goes by, and the fierce thrust of her gaze nearly knocks me against the wall. I rub the sparks from my eyes, and when I look again, the two are gone. Too late. She saw me. Train to Kulo. Shrugs, bored looks from the officers I spoke to there. You will have to go on. With regret, I went back and forth in broad daylight lanes, brightly colored cottages outlined in gleaming silver ice, and then the sky was swept with glowing indigo clouds. I wrote to my uncles, to Dull Hill Bramble, and to Found Horse Whistle. 2 days of black soda bread and stewed fruit soup. Then I sat on the train, pulling out again in dusk snow flurries. Dark blue light closed over the landscape as the station slid by, snow bearding the rough, mortared edges of its bricks. I watched the land flatten out into a piebald mat of inky blue rock and phosphorescent snow, lone naked trees studded with black birds, fewer and fewer red faces. I had a book called Syntax for Personal Narrative in my lap. I can't recall reading it. The responsibility of those who preserve events in language must be to something something. Something about narrative grid of the weft of the archive to creative intuitive form, a slot rhythm ingrained into writers, reciters, and listeners until even those events observed firsthand are experienced as if they were already written and being read back. Flatter and flatter the land, mountains always in the distance, growing lower, smoother, and more rolling, taking me away from from the land of the Nemesims. Maybe once and for all. We dropped out of the snow and the ground turned brown, then gray and pale gold as we dropped into the desert. Festive music warbles in the cafe behind me, but I am the only customer here. The wind is moving trash in the empty street. I imagine releasing the lot I hold in my hand and permitting it to escape along this street. The red and the trembling stars shout down to me, and the life that is in me shouts back. That I know I'm living goes up levels in me like surf rising against the tide marks. I've never been to the ocean, never seen it. How can I use such metaphors? I'm sure it's all very amusing, says a woman's voice, going past in the dark. You aren't on your way to death, I am. This is my moment, you get out of it. I put the money on the table and go inside. The counterman's doughy face makes him seem older than he is. Is there anywhere I can stay around here? I ask in Kvivrenu. Spare room upstairs I could let you have. He holds up three fingers. I put three coins down on the counter and he waves me along behind him, points me up the stairs to the door. The room is tiny, without windows, but not closed, because the roof is nearly half gone. An irregular round hole shows bare timbers. Warm air eddies around the room softly. There are stacks of boxes, ladder against the plaster wall, a hammock strung beneath the gap in the roof. I spin in place a little, back and forth. Not much chance, I decide, of rising sun shining on me here. Huddle under a thin felt blanket in the hammock, head down on my chest. Sound of the wind lightly dragging its fingers over the city. Tears spill from my eyes in silence. Over me is pulled a cap of vigilantly staring night. Among the constellations, I can see the flitting shapes of the imperial deputies, the Predicanten, to whose persistent attentiveness I owe my entanglement here. Although they can be any size, take any shape, now they are like little winged men, naked, hairless, and rubbery, flapping convulsively, high overhead, or clinging like bats under the eaves of the buildings. Do I dream it, or does one perch above me, peering down a long moment as I sleep? Running away? Would you be running away? The next morning I find I am looking at the changing blue sky, and rising all around me is a soft foam of treading feet. I am lying on my side now, looking at this mummy ape hand of mine. A preserved leathery paw, or fleshy antler, with a dot of reflected light glowing at each fingertip. The light going down into the tissue makes a pinkish ember of each finger. The palm is a webbing of fine creases and deep. I work my muscles and balance myself, rising onto my feet. I can just peer out the hole in the roof. I watch in fascination this white girl walking down the street, the precision bipedal movement, setting the weight down, first on this foot, then on that. Downstairs, I sway out guardedly into the cafe, where people tap crockery and talk. It's hard not to rub my eyes or my head, but my college haircut is hard to muss, and I believe I look presentable enough. Up to the counter, I point to a heap of rolls. The proprietor deftly sweeps one of them onto the plate just bust and set before him, still covered with the crumbs which technically are still the property of the previous customer, and hands it to me. So that's how it is. Sitting at the table are obvious old hands, taking their time. They will eat and stroll at their leisure to their places of business, jingling their keys and gradually opening up shop. Most regular business is confined to a commercial district straddling the river at the butt end of town. Now I'm alone. The street launches me without warning into the great sluice of another of these vast boulevards where the air is never still, flooded with sparkling bicycles that shoot, dart, and veer in shoals. The city is ribbed with vaulting aqueducts, which step on high stone pylons with arched stone groins in several leaping lines over the streets and rooftops. These aqueducts vent their water into elevated cisterns and, more spectacularly, into public fountains, descending many stories through the air in clear, discreet streams bearded with refreshing mist. The sun strikes them, making transparent membranes around the jets like a flame calyx. I wander over to a newspaper and tobacco kiosk, ask the woman if she knows where the mustering point is, or Captain Makeman. She just smiles and shakes her head. I try Chiprena, Huv, and Buzanush and get just a headshake. Got yourself drafted? Big friendly-looking fellow with a thinning black beard. He thinks the mustering point is in the place I've already checked, but I don't correct him. Sound him out instead. He turns out to be a know-it-all attached to the Surveyor's Fund. I take him up on his invitation to accompany him to his office. The natives here have always called this place Treff, at the base of the mountain. And so the city acquired that name because it was built here. Its real name is Dusk Temper. Bit strange, right? Religious separatists from Silta were the founders, and in addition to the Manual of Techniques, they had their own holy book, a kind of allegorical short story. I can't recall its name, but most of the local place names here they drew from it. Anyway, that's why the Subashi of Dusk Temper is called a pre-center instead. What was Dusk Temper named in the story? He thinks and puffs out his mouth a little. Well, it was an inner property of man, like spirit, or maybe it was a particular spirit. I think it might have meant holiness. But they had their own ideas about that. He gives me a frank look that admits he's told all he knows. And they divided the city into the two precincts? I'm not sure. It seems right. And the city I know has no other plan, but these priests and people, he waves vaguely around, aren't separatists. And I think this division involves a separate association of places that had been determined by the natives. They buried people over there, he gestures over the river, and had birth huts over on this side. The huts were raised up on high stilts, and the women would hunker down in a frame over a hatch in the floor, and the midwife or whoever would reach up and lower down the child. I ask about the separatists. He tells me there probably aren't any left anymore, or very few. A carefully ramified division of labor regulates the operation of the life and death priests. Life priests, urbane, serene, dressed in satiny white and cream gowns, preside at weddings, naming ceremonies, tend the sick, and perform healings when they can. Death priests, subdolous and mordant, dressed in shabby subfusc, officiate at funerals, conduct autopsies and embalm bodies, attend to the dying and insane, and cast out or even imbibe possessing demons. Life priests are permitted and encouraged to marry. Death priests, while not enjoined to celibacy, are forbidden to marry or to bear children. The life priests exhibit dazzling vitality. They eat only the freshest and most pure food, drink only water and fruit juice, abstain from smoking, and are alone permitted to chew benok resin, which gives them balsamic breath, shining teeth, and sparkling eyes. They smell sweet, even the old ones. The death priests, on the other hand, are sallow or even greenish in complexion, whatever their original color, with gray whites of eyes and yellow hyena teeth. They smell stale, or wear olfactorily garish perfume and shed whiffs of carrion where they go. They are forbidden more than a minimum of nourishing food, and eat almost nothing that has not been dead, preserved, or fermenting a long time. They all drink ardent spirits, smoke copiously, and most are inveterate sweet-eaters. There is no enmity between these two groups of priests, although they are compelled to avoid each other as a rule in order to maintain a pure distinction. When they do meet, a complicated protocol governs the exchange of formalities. In fact, since no one is ever born in the death precincts, all death priests are delivered into this life by life priests of the previous generation. Naturally, all life priests are ushered into whatever dream comes after by the generation of death priests who will bury them in the death district. The separatist city charter forbids the construction of churches and bans all but a handful of religious writings, and even these cannot be bought and sold in the city. They may, however, be given away. Printing religious matter is banned, although copying books by hand is not. The life and death priests conduct their ritual observations in cemeteries, hospitals, offices, libraries, basements, attics. The lifers tend to change venue often. The death priests change far less often. I was told or read that everyone visits Vesiophanes' cave sooner or later. He stood in there and wept himself to death, evidently. And this manner of dying, so gently incremental, brought about the perfect preservation of his body as a consequence of his mummy-like dehydration and the saturation of his person with his own lacrimal salt. His remains stand there still, unsupported, hands folded over his heart. The flesh of his face is pliable. His hands, his nose, even his ears are unshriveled. The air in the cave is redolent of the odor of his tears, a salty air like sea breath, but without the underlying living mustiness. Two deacons with feathers in their hair sit on the floor by his side. They live in the cave, keep watch over the saint, and further his medicine with their singing. Each takes his turn echoing the other, and the song is a long, deep sinus notes that hum in the stone, consonants as light as rustling leaves. Visitors come daily, bearing offerings of flowers and votive body parts. Organs lie embedded in enormous bouquets of flowers, and the walls, which in places have been terraced, glow with vivid ruby hearts, piles of severed arms and hands, muscles like bundles of carmine wire, platinum braids of nerves, topaz pancreases, lungs, pale rose as dusk's first shadings, plated rivers of hair, majestic livers of royal purple, slabs of snowy fat, fragrant pink brains, smelling of soluble minerals, elaborately knotted ivory intestines. By the entrance, air sluices through grates of stretched human vocal cords, the sound joining the deacon's song. All these treasures are fresh and glowing with dismembered life. They glitter in the vaults of my imagination as Beardo describes them, and seeing them so vividly in there, I feel as though a voyage to the cave itself would be redundant now. Shade of trees with long-bladed leaves. A dusty corner courtyard with cool sunlight on the stone walls. Flat, leathery pods like bumpy little belts litter the pavement. He waves me into his small office, all leather this and rosewood that. I am shown ranks and ranks of uniform volumes with gold edgings. These are the encyclopedic writings of Alok specialists about the natives here. Their history, language, religion. Of course, no Alok has ever actually visited Treff. Or if any have, they didn't draw attention to themselves, and that would have been out of character. The books were written in the capital, on the other side of the world, and brought here, unless they are copies made somewhere in between. In which case, nothing of the capital adheres to them at all. Like most of the citizens of the Empire, I have never laid eyes on an Alok. Still early in the year, Everything seems to spin away from me, as though I were near the center of a vast level wheel, which collects and disperses and collects again out of the substance and people of the city. I can feel a dizziness whirling up to me, and I have to stop and hold my head in my hands. How can I leave this place in uniform, march, and get shot at? It's a bad dream. The worst dream. I duck into the post office and line up in the clammy gloom under a low, arched ceiling. Like being inside a clam, I imagine. Deep under the sea I've never seen. The counter is marble, topped with greasy steel, and the clerk behind it is no less impassive, explaining to me that the money I was told my parents would wire to me here has not come, pointing numbly again and again to the spot in his thumby ledger where my name would be if there were any legitimate reason for me to expect such a money order, which there isn't. I feel something cold and disgusting splash behind my face, trying to ooze out of my eyes, but satisfied with warping my voice so that I can hardly make myself understood. This on the assumption that there were any human beings present to understand me. I am sickly trying to explain myself to a glazed crust filled with gray clam mush. The other patrons are understandably curious about this adventure of mine, and I can feel their runty eyes peer after me as I leave in a hurry. It all seems less gay and diverting in the stark blare of sunlight outside. I have only the few lonely amber coins of Shonley clacking in my pocket, already too little to send a message of explanation back home. What do you do with a good explanation no one can hear? I feel conspicuous and cursed. I take those ways which seem likely to lead me away from all these people who have places in the world. Of course, so do I, but it's not one I want. I reject it. I would reject it. The edic. Whenever I turn my head, small panes of glass shoot light spears at me, hurting my eyes. Now I wend along bookstall streets, funneled in light as air on the wind. Bits of paper hurry around me, in and out of shop doorways and alleys, cross and recross the street in front of me. As paper goes, it's a busy street. The books stand in neat rows, sandwiched in together, and among them sit figures perched atop tall stools within the obscurity of a deep doorway, barely visible in the gloom. My finger etches a groove in the dust that clings to spines, patched with gilt titles. Look at this, the 7 dull old syntagmas. I had to read that. Here's a bright new copy I'd buy if I had the money of Seance Paralogia by Hathabeth Hutheby, who used to be my teacher. Perhaps I could trade my syntax for it. I may never be anything better than a journeyman narrator now. If I ever were to write an account of these events, which are in any case written, my narrative would be incoherent and inconclusive. I never know enough to say. Neither buying nor selling, I keep on my walking feet that take me out from this lane of cool dust to brighter streets with shop windows, a blonde square with indistinct people strolling in the shade of a few half-sized trees in the distance. The light recoiling from the bright ground distempers the shadows and makes these people resemble figures in an old and faded picture. I beguile myself enjoying the grimaces of ranks of iron gargoyles, which rise from the gutter all the way to the dizzy steeple above. Crouch and pull faces all day, that's a good job. They're well fed and healthy, with bulbous muscles thickly rippling. I wouldn't half fit in as a woman sails by, the uplit light reflecting from her white blouse barely tints her wan face with its glow. She's not for you, nor any of them, as you know. That wasn't a very kind thought. Icy wind blows into the deepest of my spirit's stiff fractures, still hypnotized, thinking you can when you know these are impossibilities we're talking about, known only to me as my vision is clearest, clear as a bell. From the steeple, the bell can see everything in the town. Meet a woman, you will meet another. They always enter in twos. Now, how would a callow youth like myself know that? Once you see an edek, or once one sees you, you will see others. Two of them, hooded like hostages now, stalk out of the church, with their wan-faced helpers leading them. Edects are blind to this world, mostly, and see vicariously through their assistants. I don't know whether or not these helpers all wear the same mindless look because they've been put through some sort of procedure, or if an edect's presence or influence brings on this condition, but it seems like a mercy to me. The foremost edek wears a long belted black coat, badly faded. She has the air of a wasted invalid just emerging from her sick chamber with an uncanny, almost supernatural, new vigor. Her companion is in an officer's tunic, a long scarf wound round her neck many times. They angle away in the direction I came, taking long, powerful strides in near unison. And in near unison, they both abruptly turn their puncturing gaze on me, four frigid pools of congealed ink. They do not pause. Their heads re-swivel, and they go. I search for the mustering point, and the day passes. Now I am in the outer skirts, where the streets swell and contract as they please. Fewer people, and older. A hat in one of the windows catches my eye, and I stop to look at it. My eye drifts over wooden heads on stands, past the sill, and down to where an anxious cloud of dust is tumbling against the base of the building in the dry alley. Indirect sunlight sifting down from everywhere illuminates the dust faintly, and I watch the motes rise and fall in vertical orbits. On a current, I guess, of air crushed against the bricks and forced aloft. The dust looks like a woman, with a long dress and a wide hat, and now she seems closer, as though she had traversed a wide space between us and were peering through a window at me. I see her eyes, not the luster of her eyes, although there was light in the face, like a face of gold ash on a wax head, and her gaze glowed into me, without light. Water splutters from a drainpipe opposite me, and spills down a shallow channel in the dirt along the middle of the alley, thickening with dust until its front end is a bulbous brown lip. I can't see the woman anymore, nor can I remember her face. The ground is elevated here. The view is unobstructed and full of wind. The sheer black trench of the idol runs away from me, black wrinkles in a gray ribbon. And on its far side is the spherical mound of the death precinct, from which, on some nights it is recounted, one can see the titaned form of a grinning mortuary student rearing up to set a green death taper in the sky. There's the embalmer's cottage. Crouched like a toad, dropsically bloated with venom and warted over with cupolas. Its presence exceeds its size and draws attention to it among these other buildings as the eyes draw attention in the face. I walk toward the river, and in less than a quarter of a mile I find a bridge to cross into the death district. Shreds of black crepe and the dried husks of flowers that might have come from funeral wreaths rasp along the ground, are toyed with by the air. The bridge is encrusted with what look like brass teacups broken in half, like scales growing out of any order, embedded in yellow solder. I cross the empty bridge as the sun begins to slide down toward the backs of the mountains, and lights elaborate, a mechanism whirs to life around me. Night is just tuning up. So this is the death district. I find willows sighing over strewn empty streets, dust and attentive calm on the other side of the bridge. Sunset takes hours, and there are no lights lit anywhere yet. No sound but rustling skirts of air, the half-hearted whine of a shutter's hinges, crickets who chirp two or three times and stop. I wander without thinking, and as the darkness falls, I am picking my way through unlit streets with bushes growing from the pavements. In the gathering night, everything is felty and dim. The stone buildings, luminous pink and silver, with bare lividity, patched with lichen and veiled in ivy. I am thirsty, but the stone trough I find is too scummed over to drink from. I haven't eaten since the morning, and so imagine the state I'm in. I have wandered too long to go back, and my mind is unclear. I start pushing in at doors and even windows, and here one door opens. For a moment, my thoughts are sharp again. Charred beams and broken plaster on the floor, smashed furniture. Walls glow white-blue, like cheeses. Here on the window still a chipped tin cup with a little sand at the bottom is nearly full of rainwater. I drink it down carefully so as not to drink the sand. I can feel it pouring down cold into my empty stomach. There's even a thin, narrow mattress or pad here, folded on the floor. I pull my jacket around myself and lie down on my side. My body groans with fatigue, but it takes me a while, or so it seems, to get to sleep, listening to the wind and the faint sound of settling dust.